Hello and welcome. Today we're going to cover just one topic, which is the IMU, the Inertial Measurement Unit. Now we're going to talk specifically about the six-axis IMU, and although I did cover this up here in 12B of the Dynamic ESA series, I still get questions about the IMU and how on earth does it interface with the rest of the electronic systems, in particular with Dynamic ESA. So I thought I'd make one standalone episode to explain what the IMU does. So I'm going to do my best. So first of all, what we need to do is understand what are the six axes of movement that the IMU measures, and then we need to explore what do the engineers do with these data streams to give us the different ride modes on our motorbikes. Now they can create them so that the bike is incredibly safe and doesn't move around, or in the case of their sports bikes, you have quite a bit of movement on your motorbike, wheelies, stoppies, sliding, all kinds of things, so that there is these two extremes. But we need to understand, first of all, what are the data streams that the IMU measures? Let's get started. So you might be thinking, what's he doing with a piece of wood and a couple of tennis balls? Well, this little prop is going to help me explain to you how the IMU works. And we need to understand that to understand how the engineers have created all these algorithms and the suspension profiles for our bikes. And it's quite interesting. So the IMU, if we think of that, it's a little tiny module, sits underneath on the GS, it sits underneath the rear passenger seat. Now the module's about so big. Inside it, there are two types of module. There is a gyroscope and there is an accelerometer. There's actually three of each, but for terms of explaining this, we'll just call it a gyroscope and an accelerometer. And they each measure three different movements of axis. So the one we need to look at first is the accelerometer. So if you imagine this is the bike, look at the wood, don't look at me. This is the motorbike. We're going to look at the accelerometer first and look at the three motions it measures. The first one's really simple. It's the movement forward and it's the movement back. Forward and back. That's the first movement. The second one is even simpler. It would be, for example, when we're going in dips and undulations on the road, it's a movement down and it's a movement up. This is what that area of the sensor is measuring, down and up. The third movement that the accelerometer is going to measure is a movement to the left or a movement to the right. And that would be, for example, if you were turning into a corner and both wheels started to slide, the bike would move sideways. That's not going to happen very often, but that's what that sensor's capable of measuring, the complete movement of the motorcycle in unison, left or right. So the second part of the sensor, there is a gyroscope. There's actually three, and what they measure is something completely different. So the first one we're going to talk about is what they refer to as pitch. Now again, I'm going to turn sideways. Imagine this is the bike. When we get on the gas and we accelerate, the front of the bike raises, the back of the bike dips. This is called pitch. It's the same thing when we brake hard for corner entry, the front of the bike dips and the back of the bike comes up. So this is called pitch. The next one is called roll, but we can think of this in terms of lean angle. That's the easiest way to look at this one. So as we lean into a left-hand corner, the sensor measures the amount of lean that the motorcycle makes from its vertical position, both to the right and to the left. But not only that, it's going to measure the speed of change. So we could be slowly turning into a corner, or if, for example, we're on the S1000RR and we're slapping the bike into the corner, it also measures the speed of change. Now, the last one that the gyroscope measures is something called yaw. This is not so easy to understand, but I'll do my very best. So if you imagine I'm on the motorbike, we're traveling at a constant speed, we're neither accelerating or deaccelerating, we're not going left and right, it will measure a movement, a turning movement, to the left or to the right. So you might be thinking, well, that's never going to happen on a motorbike, but it does. So let me explain. So again, this is the motorcycle. The motorcycle is traveling in the direction of you, the viewer. We're braking hard for corner entry, so the bike is pitching forward. The back of the bike has become very light, and the back of the bike steps out. So although R direction of travel is still towards you, the viewer. Look at the motorbike. The motorbike is now pointing in a different direction, and this is called yaw. So it means the motorbike is pointing in a different direction and traveling in a different direction. So it's got two things going on. So this also applies to really gifted riders like Casey Stoner and Valentino Rossi. So when they get to the apex of the corner and they get on that gas, what happens is that the back wheel starts to rotate faster than the front wheel. Something's got to give, something's got to move, so the back of the bike steps out. So although their direction of travel is still in a straight line at this point, the bike has changed its attitude and is pointing in a different direction. So the sensor is able to detect not only you're going around the corner, but the bike steps out of line. So again, although we're still traveling towards the corner, the bike is still at a different angle. So that's the IMU, but you also need to understand that the sensors not only measure these changes in direction, but they measure the speed of the change of direction, and this is really important. So on the front of our bikes, just under here on our front shock absorber, on the telelever unit, there is a sensor inside the shock absorber, and it measures the speed at which the suspension compresses. The same on the rear shock absorber. On the bottom, there's another sensor that measures the speed of compression. So what they're able to do when we're on our motorbikes and we get to a series of bends, we're going pretty fast, we turn into the bend really quickly, it is able to detect not only the lean angle, it can detect the speed at which we turn into that corner, and it also can detect the speed at which the suspension compresses. So if the suspension compresses quickly, the systems on the bike detect that really quickly, and they can close the compression valve circuit on the front or the rear or both at the same time in terms of the damper. So it slows the compression of the shock absorber down. In other words, when we're braking hard for corner entry and we grab a handful of front brake, the front starts to dip, that shock absorber and the IMU are all providing information to the ECU, and the ECU says, well, under those scenarios, we're going to offer support on the shock absorber, it closes the compression valve circuit, and it stops that front shock absorber compressing too quickly. It is very, very clever stuff. There's a lot of other sensors all partaking in this decision-making process, and all of these data streams like throttle input, engine temperature, volume of air moving through those induction ports, it all goes towards making something called an algorithm. And then those algorithms generate what the suspension is going to do at any given moment, taking into account all this information from the sensor systems, also taking into account what you as a rider have asked for, not only in terms of riding mode, but in terms of rear preload setting and the damping setting. So there's an awful lot going on, and I hope that explains it a little bit more. Let's move on. So hopefully now we have a better understanding of what the six axis IMU is measuring in terms of the six axes of movement. Now, before we move on into ride modes, there are actually four classifications of IMU. And for the automotive industry, for motorbikes and cars, we actually use the lowest level, and it's quite often referred to as a class one device. Up through those categories, we move into class two, which is quite often used in manufacturing. They're more accurate, they're more robust. And then we move up into class three, which is the military applications. And because of their environmental conditions, they are a lot more robust, they're more accurate. And quite often you actually move from six axes to nine axes, and that really is for a separate video, because that's actually also very interesting. What, in addition to those six axes that we looked at, do the nine axis systems monitor? And then finally, in class four, we're into aviation and flight control systems. Now, there is a huge difference in price between these class one devices fitted to our motorbikes and cars and the Class 4 systems used in aviation. These ones up here will cost you tens of thousands, if not some of them, some of the high altitude ones, they're very, very expensive. We're talking hundreds of thousands of dollars for those systems. But in flight systems, we're talking tens of thousands. Whereas down here in Class 1, which we get in our automotive industry, although we as a customer would probably spend around £150, £200 for a replacement unit, actual cost to the manufacturers is about, well, it's under $10 or $10 or $15. It's really not very expensive. Also, the manufacturing techniques that they use between each of these categories is very different. We have actually quite a very simple, although it's an electrical system, there is a mechanical element to it. But as you move up through these different categories, it gets a lot more complex and a lot more accurate. So let's move on now and see what the engineers do with these data streams to give us all these different ride modes. Let's have a look. So now we have all these different data streams from the sensors on the motorbike, not just the IMU, but the rest of the control systems. We've got all this information. So what do the manufacturers do to create these ride modes? Well, in a moment, I'm going to use the word safe or a safety net. And it's probably at this point, I should help you understand what that really means. So if you were to draw a circle around you and your motorbike and all your gear, and that circle was as close as physically it could be without touching the motorbike, that is a safe, secure safety net. And the motorbike in that mode is designed not to move around. For example, in those first three lower categories, for example, if we pick road mode, the systems on the bike, including the IMU, are designed for maximum traction, maximum grip. So that rear wheel and that front wheel are designed to stay on the road to provide maximum grip. So there's not going to be any wheelies allowed, you can't do any stoppies, and when you're braking hard for corner entry, that rear wheel is kept firmly on the road so that they can get some braking force through the front and the rear. But then when you move into dynamic mode, for example, that circle, that safety net that surrounds you and your motorbike starts to move outward. Now, it doesn't mean that it's dangerous, but it just means that as that safety net gets bigger, that level of protection is slightly reduced because the bike can then start to move around within that circle that you and the motorbike are in. But then what happens is the system allows the front wheel to come up. It doesn't come up very high and then it puts it back down on the road again, but it does allow the front wheel to come up. And also with regards to the rear of the bike, if you're braking hard for corner entry, the back of the bike then can come up off the road. It's not, again, very much, but it can move around. And if you're not used to this sort of thing, it can be a bit unnerving. And then in particular, when we get into what BMW called Dyna-Pro or Dyna-Pro settings, you have to be really careful. And if you choose that mode, you are in effect telling your motorbike you are a professional rider and you know what you're doing, and you better know what you're doing in that setting, because you can turn systems off on in that system in Dyna-Pro that have a huge effect on the bike. So the engineers have a huge amount of options and a huge amount of ability to control these different systems. And a lot of it starts with the tires, with traction, because that's the base point from which they've got to decide what's going to happen with the systems. Now, what's interesting is depending on the tires, the tire compounds, the tire construction, there are different grip levels at different lean angles. So for example, with ABS Pro, when you're probably all aware that when you're leaned over in a corner and you're using a system that's got cornering assist, even if you grab quite a handful of that front brake lever, the ABS system measures the amount of pressure that you're pulling on that lever, and it won't send all of that pressure to the front and the rear brake, because the engineers have already decided during development and testing of the tires that the manufacturer is going to use on your bike, at which point that traction will break free and those tires slide. So hopefully you've enjoyed today and you've learned something about the IMU, the different sensor systems on our motorbikes, and how the engineers use those data streams to create our ride profiles and to give us a very safe bike, if that's the option we choose, or at the other end of the scale, we've got a motorbike that can give us a lot of fun if you're prepared for a motorbike that's going to move around quite a lot. Anyway, thank you very much for your time, and I'll see you very soon. Bye-bye.